Well, good afternoon. Welcome to Christchurch. Lovely to see you, although I don't know where everyone else is. It's just good weather. We should pray for rain. Oh, no, I'm kidding. So welcome. Welcome if you're watching from a different angle this week. We've moved the camera. But I hope you're doing okay. It's Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, and then, of course, Easter Sunday this week. And we're sort of using a passage from Maundy, Thursday for today. Just bringing it forward a day to Wednesday. I'm going to start with a hymn that is focused on the cross. It's When I Survey. That is something that we need to keep doing as Christians, surveying the cross, because in the cross that we see how much we are loved, not because of us, but because of who God is, that he loves us because of what Christ did on that cross. So if you'd like to stand, we'll have that as our first hymn, which we can't sing, sadly, here in the building. If you want to sing it outside, if that's fine, but at home, do sing along. And we'll listen to it and remind ourselves of the truths of these words. Please be seated. We're going to ask for God to help us to live our lives based on that cross of Jesus Christ that demands our all. And we use these words, this prayer, asking God to do that in us. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline our hearts to keep this law. Well, I'm just going to mention what's happening. This is notices at this point, just to let us know, let you know at home what is happening. And you can see there, Easter Day coming up the 4th of April, not March. We don't do time travel or anything like that. That's the mistake, the accidental mistake that you need. It's like finding spot the difference or spot the mistake. Usually there's one somewhere. So 4th of March, but it is Easter Day. 4th of April, sorry, it is Easter Day. And service in here at 9 o'clock, at 10:30 at St John's. No children's groups online at all, but children might be there in the morning, I guess. Please just book in for that. But there is in the afternoon a car park service, 4 o'clock in St John's. We can sing outside. So we look forward to doing that on Easter Day. You don't have to wait till Easter Day because Good Friday, you can also do that as well. But before that, there's home groups. I think there's one home group. There's two home groups meeting together as one tonight. So the Wednesday groups are meeting together in the church virtual chat room, if that makes sense to you. Good. If it doesn't, don't worry. But other groups might be able to. Is your group meeting, Steph?
Because
you're waiting till after Easter. Okay. Right, okay. So I hope you bring your eggs and share them. but you can meet in gardens, can't you, and in parks as well, and the weather's good for that at the moment. So there we go, groups are meeting. But just to say, on Friday there is a service up at St John's in the car park. We sing, we'll reflect on the cross using most of Luke 23, just going through the story of the cross there, so you can sing along. Join us for that. We'll spread out with cones. You can sit down or stand, however you feel best. Someone's asking, do you need to bring your own chair? If you want to bring your own chair, that's helpful. But if you, some people are folding chairs, whether it's garden or camp chairs, there are some chairs available, but there's probably not chairs for everyone. So there probably will be enough chairs if you struggle. But if you're fit and energetic and able to bring your own, that does help. Okay. Next Wednesday, the service will not be online. It won't be recorded. It won't be going online. I'm not absolutely sure if it will even happen, but it probably will. We haven't had a discussion about this, have we, Julian? No. So it might not even happen. But look out for the notices, and you'll find out. We'll know by Sunday if it will even happen. We do know it definitely won't be going online. So, sorry. Have a week off, Christchurch, next Wednesday if you're in the habit of watching along. But the week after we'll be back to normal, either way. And what else is on here? Don Middleton's funeral on, if you know him, quite well known in Hebburn. His funeral's on Monday the 12th around lunchtime. It's family only in attendance, but it will be on YouTube if you wish to watch it there, or watch as the cars come down Station Road. You might want to be there at that point. But just to draw your attention to the annual meetings here at Christchurch, it will be on Wednesday the 28th after this service, a quick meeting to reflect and to pray. And if you want to be on the electoral roll here, which is basically saying this is kind of the church that I belong to and support, there are some forms at the back you can fill in to do that. And there are ways of, if you want to be on the PCC or church warden, Jackie would love it. So if you're willing to do that, do be in touch and we'll sort that out as well if you're interested in those things. Yes, she is on the next version of this notice sheet, yeah. But this is the last Sunday's notice sheet and she hadn't sadly passed away. So yeah, if Marilyn Merrin passed away, when was that now?
Wednesday.
It wouldn't have been last Wednesday. It was just before. Yeah, it's definitely the last few days. Anyway, within the last week, she was very involved in the Baptist Church over the road, and other churches more widely together. Sad loss, and pray for Roy. She's with Christ, so she's fine. But it's sad for us who remain. And yet, it is Easter that proclaims that hope, doesn't it, in the resurrection through Jesus Christ. Well, we're going to have a Bible reading, and Gillian, if you're going to come and read it for us, please, because Gillian's going to reflect on this in a moment from Luke 22, page 1057 in the Bibles. If you've got one, just remember to drop it on the table at the back. Well, drop it, place it on the table at the back. But over to Gillian. Thank you.
Our readings from Luke
chapter 22, starting at verse 7. It's on page 1057. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." "Where do you want us to prepare for it?" they asked. He replied, "If you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Gillian. If you'd like to stand, we'll say the words of the Creed, the Apostles' Creed this time, and affirm our faith in the God who we know is Father, revealed in the Son, and close to us by the Holy Spirit. So we say together, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." Well, please be seated as we reflect on that reading again.
I must be getting weaker. This feels heavy. Let us start in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you humbly as we listen to your passion. May it ring so true to our very soul of what you've done for to save us. Come, Holy Spirit, work within us. Let us hear your voice, Lord. Let us understand your word. Amen. In America, a person condemned to die is allowed to select a meal, what's called a special meal, before execution. What a prisoner eats and drinks is often published because people want to know what the condemned criminal chose to eat and drink before dying. You could ask the same question about Jesus. He too was about to be condemned to die. And he had one last meal on Thursday evening before dying the next day. In a very intentional way, Jesus chose to have a Passover meal as his last meal with his disciples. A few hours after eating the Passover meal, Jesus was betrayed by Judas Iscariot and arrested. By early Friday morning, Jesus had endured four kangaroo trials, mocking, abuse, a denial by Peter, and a Roman flogging that almost killed him. Jesus was then crucified before noon, dead by late afternoon, and buried before sundown. The final meal eaten by Jesus is often called the Last Supper. However, there really are two meals eaten that night. Jesus and his disciples ate the final divinely sanctioned Passover meal, and at the same time, Jesus inaugurated the first divinely sanctioned Lord's Supper, which was to be eaten by Jesus' disciples on a regular basis until he returns. So today, we are going to look at the last Passover meal and the first Lord's Supper. Luke said in verse 7, "Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed." It was Thursday morning, the day of Passover. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." Most likely, Jesus sent Peter and John on this errand because he didn't want Judas to know ahead of time where they would be celebrating the Passover meal. He didn't want Judas's imminent betrayal to interfere with his plans to eat the Passover meal with his disciples. Understandably, Peter and John asked Jesus, "Where do you want us to prepare for it?" Mind, in Jerusalem, most of the citizens would rent out rooms to pilgrims so they could celebrate the Passover. Because you've got to keep in mind, there were hundreds of thousands of pilgrims in Jerusalem. It would be chocker. And if you hadn't prepared beforehand, you would be very fortunate to find somewhere to sleep. But Jesus replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you." Well, usually women carried water, so a man carrying a jar of water would be easily spotted. Jesus continues, "Follow him to the house that he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished. Make preparations there.'" Well, presumably, Jesus had made previous arrangements with the owner of the house. And so Peter and John went and found it just as Jesus had told them. And they spent the rest of the day getting ready all the food and drink, and they prepared for this Passover. Do you see? Jesus was sovereignly in control. In fact, throughout the next 36 hours, it may seem as if things were out of control, but everything was developing according to God's divine plan. There may be times in our lives when things seem to be out of control, but if we seek to obey God as Jesus did, then we can have assurance that God is sovereignly working all things out for his glory and our ultimate good. Well, if we take a look at eating of the Passover, I'm not sure whether everybody knows, but I'll go through this little bit. The Passover meal commemorated the deliverance of the people of Israel from their slavery in Egypt. On that night, the angel of death killed all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. However, in order to preserve the life of the firstborn of their families, God told the people of Israel that they were to kill an unblemished lamb and spread its blood on the lintels and doorposts of the house. When the angel of death saw the blood, he would pass over them and spare the life of the firstborn. Because the meal was eaten in haste, there was no time to bake bread with leaven. And so, that first Passover meal was eaten while standing. The people of God were about to leave their bondage of slavery in Egypt. But in Jesus' day, the Jews no longer ate the Passover meal standing. They reclined because they were no longer slaves. When the sun set at about 6 p.m., the Passover meal was eaten, and the week-long feast of unleavened bread began. The hour came. Jesus reclined at the table along with the 12 apostles. They were about to begin when he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." Two things. First, Jesus had an immense longing to eat this Passover meal with his disciples. He was about to suffer and be crucified in order to save sinners. But his great desire was to eat his last meal with those whom he came to save. The Hebrew word "until" does not necessarily imply that something will happen again. Jesus was telling his disciples that this was their last Passover. Soon the sacrament would find its true fulfillment in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they would never have occasion to celebrate it together again. Instead, the people of God would celebrate the new sacrament and the new covenant in Christ by eating the bread and drinking of the wine of the Lord's Supper. Luke said that Jesus took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." The cup that is mentioned here is the first cup of the Passover meal. There's actually four that they have. Don't worry, they don't get drunk because they dilute it, so I found out. But I didn't want to bore you with all those bits. So Jesus gave thanks to God, presumably for the wonderful way in which God saves his people. But then, instead of having each disciple drink from his own cup, Jesus had them drink from a common cup when he said, "Take this and divide it among you." Jesus was emphasizing the communal aspect of the meal. They were in fellowship with one another, in communion. Jesus went on to say that he would not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. You see, Jesus was helping his disciples to understand that a transition was about to take place. The Passover meal celebrated the exodus of God's people out of their bondage of slavery in Egypt. It was a celebration of the old covenant. Now, Jesus was about to institute the Lord's Supper, which is a celebration of a greater exodus of God's people out of spiritual bondness of sin. By the death of Jesus, the Lord's Supper is a celebration of the new covenant. The Lord's Supper is a sacrament of fellowship with Jesus and with other Christians. So the Passover meal continues. Jesus was the host, of course, and he would have led them in the various stages of the meal. At some point, when the sacrificial lamb was eaten along with the unleavened bread, Jesus instituted what we call the Lord's Supper. Luke said that Jesus took the bread, gave it to them, gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The unleavened bread represented the bread of affliction because it reminded the people of God of their persecution as slaves in Egypt. The unleavened bread was now given a new and greater significance. It represented Jesus' body and the affliction he would endure on the cross. Jesus' statement was full of significance. "This is my body," means that the unleavened bread represents his body. "Given for you" speaks of the gift of himself on the cross, paying the penalty for our sins. "Do this in remembrance of me" teaches us that God's people are to celebrate the Lord's Supper regularly, and whenever they do so, they are to remember all that Jesus has done to pay the penalty for our sin and reconcile us to God. At this point, Jesus and his disciples must have continued eating the main portion of the meal. When it was time to drink the third cup of wine, Jesus took the cup after they had eaten and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." The cup represents the blood of Jesus and his sacrificial death on the cross. By calling the cup the new covenant in my blood, Jesus was replacing the old covenant of the constant shedding of blood of the sacrificial lambs of the Passover with a once for all shedding of his own blood to pay the penalty for our sin. The Old Testament, God made a covenant with his people through Moses and speaks significantly about the blood of the covenant. On the day that covenant was confirmed, Moses collected the blood of the people's sacrifices into a large basin and threw half of it on the altar, and he took the other half and threw it on the people, saying, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made for you." The old covenant was sealed in blood. This was a sign of God's mercy, for the blood on the altar showed that the people had forgiveness for their sins, while the blood sprinkled on the people showed that they themselves were included in the covenant of salvation. That was the old covenant. The old covenant required the people of God to shed blood constantly in order to remind them of the promises of God. But Jesus instituted the new covenant. What is so unique about the new covenant is that it is established by the blood of God himself. Jesus shed his blood in a once-for-all sacrifice to pay the penalty for our sins. God would no longer require the shedding of blood to pay the penalty for sin, because he paid the penalty for sin by shedding his own blood. Jesus' last meal as one who was condemned to die, was utterly significant. It was not a meal that he wanted for himself, as condemned criminals want on the eve of their execution. Rather, Jesus was thinking of a meal to give to his followers. His disciples would remember this. Remember when he makes his sacrifice. They would never forget, as we should never forget. Christ's death on the cross for the life of our souls. If you understand this sacrament and the sacrifice that it signifies, then you will know Jesus desires to share his supper with you every bit as eagerly as he wanted to share it with his disciples the night of the First Supper. Jesus died for you, for me, as much as he died for them. And he loves you as much as he loves them. It is for you, for us, that the bread is given, and for us that the cup is poured, because it is for us that his body was given and his blood was shed. How deep the Father's love for us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, move us all when we hear your story. Don't ever let us forget the price you paid. Touch our hearts. Instill in us the wonders that you bring at the price, the ultimate price you had to pay. Amen.
We're going to continue in prayer now, in thankfulness to God. Let us pray. So Lord God, we thank you that you do love us and that you love the world that has turned its back on you in many ways. So we pray for the world now. We pray for areas of conflict, areas of tension, areas of disagreements. Lord, we pray that you would help different groups in the community, whether it be social status or ethnic background or age or qualifications or income or political opinions. So easy for people to be divided, and especially so in this situation we've been in the last year, where people haven't been able to talk to each other face to face very much, where a lot of discussion has been at a distance or been online, and often words have been addressed, but actually there are real people involved. And Father God, we pray that you would help communities to come together. Lord, we pray that as restrictions are lifted and as people seek to get back with their friends, they would seek to engage with different opinions, that there'd be a greater sense of humility and a greater sense of willingness to listen, that this would be good for our world. Because all of us have gone through some common experiences. All the countries of the world need to work together. And Lord God, we know that ultimately this unity only comes through Jesus' death itself, that unites us not only with you, wonderful as that is, but also with each other, bringing peace and reconciliation and forgiveness with you and for each other. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for churches across the world this Easter time, where in many countries they don't have the freedom or the safety that we enjoy here in England. We know that in the past on Easter Day, certain churches in certain countries have been attacked bombed even, and Christians have lost their lives because they want to meet and celebrate and support one another in the resurrection and the death of Jesus. So, Lord, we pray for these Christians. We pray, yes, for their safety. Most of all, we pray for their courage. And, Lord, that even where they might suffer, that willingness testifies to those who would hurt them that the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ and what he gives us cannot be taken away from us, not even in death. So, Lord, we pray for the persecuted church, knowing that that is often where the church grows fastest, where your light shines brightest. And Lord, we pray that your justice will, knowing your justice will come one day, and that that would hold these Christians fast in their faith. And may that help us as Christians here in the West to be woken up from our complacency, from our lukewarmness often in our faith, where we meet people we love but don't really think they really need Jesus when they desperately do. Lord God, we pray that you would support those persecuted Christians and stir up a passion for us here who don't face those issues. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we want to pray for people who are suffering and struggling at this time, struggling with their health, perhaps struggling physically or mentally. Maybe there are people close to them who are struggling. Maybe there are people we know who are struggling with their circumstances regarding work in this uncertain time. Lord God, maybe there are people we know who are uncertain with all that's going on with these vaccines coming out and the way that people have raised hesitancy and scepticism about that. Lord, we pray for your truth to prevail and for your goodness to work in people's lives. Where people are suffering, may your healing come. And where that healing seems to not be coming, may the hope you want for people not subside. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray for those who mourn. We pray for the family and friends of Carol McGibbon, Doris Snaith, Don Middleton, and Marilyn Merrin. Lord, we pray for others who mourn as well. But Lord, we pray that as these families and friends approach Easter, that those who trust in Christ, the sure and certain hope we have that they are risen, will be risen again with Jesus, because he is indeed risen. And Father God, in their sadness and in their loss and in the emptiness they feel, may they know that you are close by them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So Father God, we thank you for all the gifts you've given us. Thank you for the reminders. Thank you for the symbols that feed our faith, such as bread and wine and water of baptism, these sacraments Christ has given. May they continue to sustain us in our faith, proclaiming your gospel message to us in physical ways, whilst we resolve to keep hearing your word in the scriptures. So merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to receive the bread and wine, as Jesus commanded us to do, to eat and drink in remembrance of him, and to proclaim his death until he returns again. Before we do that, we confess our sins. So you who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from this day forward in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and lead us to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear these words of comfort that our Saviour Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Hear what St. Paul says. This saying is true and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear what St. John says. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. So lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy at all times and all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who in your tender mercy gave your only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. He instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we, receiving these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he is betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper he took the cup, and when he had given thanks he gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen. So in a moment, as you draw near with faith, may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve your body and soul for everlasting life. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ has died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. So as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of your Spirit to live and work your praise and glory. Amen. So we're going to have a closing hymn. It's Thine Be the Glory. Jesus Christ has died, but he is the risen conquering Son. He's conquered sin and death for us. We stand in his victory over death that he has won. We stand in the victory that Christ has won over death because he went through death for us as he shed his blood, broke his body, as we've remembered today. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and forevermore. Amen.